Thank you, Abby, and good afternoon to everyone. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to see that GCC has such a robust peace studies program. So I started Karuna Center for Peace Building in 1994. Karuna means compassion. It comes from the ancient languages of India, from Sanskrit and Pali. And I chose that word because when I first started to do my work, I thought I was going to work primarily in Asia. And it's really compassion that inspired me to start doing this. And then it turned out that we did start in Asia, but we wound up with programs in Africa and the Mideast and Eastern Europe and other places. And we kept the name Karuna because we want to talk to people about the role of compassion in building peace, which is, I think, a very important part of peace building. So that's what Karuna means. And Karuna is an NGO. Do you know what an NGO is? A non-government organization. Interesting, the whole world calls them non-government organizations. The US calls them nonprofits. Think about that and what that tells us about the difference between the US and the rest of the world approach. There are uncountable millions of NGOs in the world. And it's a pretty new movement that started maybe in the 60s and 70s and has grown primarily because the governments are not doing their job. So the work is in peace building, the work is in development, the work is in healthcare, in education, in HIV/AIDS, in so many other fields that the governments don't seem able to do. And so this movement of NGOs has risen up over the decades. And what I discover is that when I'm in a country just after an armed conflict has ended, thousands of people are registering to start NGOs. Some of them are serious and do really good work. Others are people's opportunities to hope international money will fall into their pockets. And they register and they never mean anything. But I was in Macedonia just after the violence ended there, and about 4,000 NGOs had started up in just a matter of months. So there are very large NGOs that you'll recognize, like CARE and the Red Cross and these other huge mega organizations, Oxfam. And then there are organizations like Karuna Center. Our office is in Amherst and our staff is 4 people. So although we work worldwide, we work from a very small base here. It's estimated that India alone has about 2 million NGOs, just in one country. Of course, one of the biggest countries in the world, but just in one country. So it's a very robust movement and it's doing a great deal of good right now. They're guessing that Russia has about 250,000 NGOs. And again, it's a reflection of work that needs to be done that's not getting done by our governments. Our work is specifically devoted to education and training. Not every NGO can do everything. We don't do welfare, we don't do relief, we don't provide drinking water, we don't provide seeds. We provide education and training. My background is in mental health. I'm a psychologist by profession, and I'm interested in human relationships and in helping people build bridges of understanding that prevent conflict and that help people recover from conflict. So we're an education and training NGO. And we work in places where local partners have invited us. One of the things that I'm very cautious about as an American is not to go where I'm not invited. America's done too much of that. America goes a lot of places where we're not invited and perhaps shouldn't be. So I want to make sure that every place we go, a local partner, a local NGO or academic institution or government has invited us to work with them. Right now, I'm working in Nepal with their parliament. I'm working in Israel and Palestine with civil society leaders. I'm working in Sri Lanka with religious leaders. So it varies from country to country, the work that we do, the training that we do. And when we are invited into a country, if there's a good fit, we make a multi-year commitment. So I'm commuting from Boston to Kathmandu, which is not an easy commute. It takes 2 days to get there. And I'm going 3 or 4 times a year because we've made a commitment to work with the Nepalese and their political process as they attempt to form their government. And when I went to Bosnia, I worked for 6 years. So we don't fly around the world and drop in someplace and then disappear. We make commitments to communities and we try to do deep work with them. Okay, let's have the first slide, please. This is a picture I took in Afghanistan I was there in 2007. Afghanistan's a tough place to be, but an important place to be. And it's a reminder of how countries go from glory to despair. This was the palace, once a very beautiful building, and now it's complete rubble. And moving from the rise and fall of empires. It's an empire that rose up and that then sort of disappeared again completely. And it's a reminder of the kind of work that we're faced with, which is having to rebuild from the ground up. And although we don't do the infrastructure, this is the infrastructure that people face every day, which is a very challenging infrastructure. Okay. So the title that I was asked to talk about, The Roots of Peace, the interest here in Abby's series, after looking at the roots of war last year, is looking at the roots of peace this year. And I said stormy world because it is a stormy world. It's a world filled with violent conflict, awash with weapons, swamped with misunderstanding and misperception of each other, which is all now exacerbated by a very out of control international media. So it is a stormy world in which we're building peace. And one of the important things about building peace is for people to know each other in a deep way. It has seemed to me as I've worked that we may know more about war than we know about peace. So Abby's instinct after looking at the roots of war to look at the roots of peace is very important. And I want to, next slide please. I want to show you something called the Global Peace Index, a very interesting instrument. It was developed about 3 or 4 years ago. An Australian dot-com millionaire wanted to do something decent with his money and his life. And he set about this task. He hired the Time Newsweek, the Economist, intelligence unit to develop this. They have studied about 120 countries so far, and they keep studying them, looking for the indexes of peace instead of war. And they measure every country with 24 matrices. They kind of make a web of each country. And the matrices have to do with both international relations and internal domestic relations. And then they've come up with a list of the most peaceful and the most warlike countries in the world. We're looking at three different categories. One is negative peace. Negative peace means the war is stopped. It doesn't mean there's a culture of peace. It means the war has stopped. There's at least a ceasefire. Positive peace is a peace where social, political, and economic institutions have been established so people can begin to live in more safety. But a culture of peace is the furthest along and the most difficult of all of these to attain. And what we're looking at are developing cultures of peace. A culture of peace has said, we will not use violence to solve our problems. Conflict, by the way, is not the problem. Conflict is a normal fact of human life. In fact, one of my teachers once said, if you want a world without conflict, you've been born on the wrong planet. Because here on planet Earth, we have conflict. The problem is not conflict. We have conflict inside ourselves, in our families, in our relationships, in our work, in our school. It's normal. The worry is violence. The worry is solving our conflict problems, either in a way that is verbal and compassionate and relational, or in a way that is violent and destructive. So people keep thinking conflict is the problem, but it's the escalation of conflict into violence that's a problem. Okay, next slide. Here's a map of the world with the states that they've measured. The ones in white are not yet measured because they've had so much violent conflict they haven't been able to do it. The dark blue is the prize. Those are the most culture of peace country, prone countries that we've got in the world. And you can notice that a lot of them are European, but we also have Australia, New Zealand, Japan, Canada, Chile. So there's Uruguay, quite a few countries that are not Northern European that are also considered the most peaceful places. Now again, the measure was not just war, but prisons, homelessness, domestic violence, educational levels, treatment of immigrants, foreign relations, neighborhood relations, export of weapons, manufacture of weapons. All these things are laid out to get these indexes. Next slide, please. So there's the top 20. Take a look, what do you notice? What do you notice about them?
Could I turn the half lights again?
Turn on the lights?
Halfway.
Half the lights?
Yeah.
Can you still see the screen? Okay, so what do you notice about this list? Take a look and tell me what you notice.
United States not even there.
Oh, not even close. I'll tell you where we are later. The United States is not there. What else do you notice?
Mostly European.
Mostly European.
And the top one is Scandinavian. Scandinavia is way up there.
Way up there. Norway, Denmark, Finland, Sweden are way up there. Good observation. What else do you notice? What about the economic level of these countries? High. Any exceptions? Ireland's not too high. Ever hear of Bhutan, number 19? Where's Bhutan?
Near India.
It's near India, high in the Himalayas, and it's the only economically not developed country on the list. So one of the things we learn immediately is the connection between peace and economic security. Not necessarily wealth, but economic security. Because countries like Slovakia or Slovenia or Czech Republic or Portugal are not wealthy countries, but there's a very comfortable standard of living. So that's a pretty interesting, you got a question?
Yeah, well, I just noticed how many of the countries that were at war or suffered war in World War II are
nice,
on the list.
Exactly. So there's something interesting because sometimes my students in war zones feel, we're never gonna get out of this. We're gonna be doing this in our lifetime, our kids' lifetime, our grandkids' lifetime. And I talk about Europe. And I say, I don't think the French and Germans are gonna go to war with each other. I don't think the Japanese and Americans are gonna go to war with each other. I think that over time, this changes. And countries that have had very violent conflict have figured out other ways to resolve their problems. I was in Norway last summer because I was speaking at a conference there, and I learned that the Norwegians and the Swedes have a very old animosity. And it's based on long period of warfare. It would never occur to them to pick up a gun now to try to solve a dispute between them. So these things can change. Can I have the next slide, please? Take a look at the bottom. They've now looked at 121 countries, so this is 101 to 121. The US is not there either. What do you notice about these countries? Where are they and what do you notice about them? What? Middle East, a lot in Middle East, where else?
Africa,
a lot in Africa, very sad. A lot in Africa, a lot in the Middle East. And we say there's some studies that have shown that countries that have had violent conflict have a very high percentage chance of going back to it within 5 years. So a lot of these countries are worries because even the ones that are not at war now are likely to return to war within 5 years. It's very hard to get stable. Countries become what we call conflict habituated, just like families become conflict habituated. If a family has a style of violence in the home, that tends to become a habit or a pattern and it's hard to break it. If a country has a habit of dealing with violence by creating more violence, dealing with problems by creating war, it's more likely to return to that. So these countries are a concern for us because many of them will fall back into conflict. The US is number 85. Not a great position for such an economically developed country. But again, the measures have to do with our external and our internal relations. You probably know that after China, we have the highest prison population in the world. That's a very bad mark on the Global Peace Index. And we have so many internal problems as well as making war, manufacturing weapons, and so forth. So the U.S. doesn't score very well. Sometimes when I show this to my international students, they think the U.S. should be a number 121, because so many of them feel the effects of the violent conflict. And they say, 85, that's pretty good. You know, so again, these are supposedly objective measures, and it's just to give you a picture of looking at cultures of war and cultures of peace and how we get there. So I think it's, and if you want to look at it, it's on the website, Global Peace Index, you can find it. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So this is my other hat. I have two hats, and I have brochures here for each hat. You can help yourself too. I founded Karuna Center in 1994, 16 years ago, and our office is in Amherst. And I'm also a professor at the School for International Training right up the road here in Brattleboro. And I teach in a master's program in peace and conflict. And I run a peace-building institute called CONTACT, which stands for Conflict Transformation Across Cultures. There's brochures for both these things. Help yourselves on the way out. I started CONTACT because I was teaching at SIT, and I was traveling around the world, and I would say to the Sri Lankans, there's something important the Israelis are doing you should know about. And I would say to the Israelis, there's an interesting process in Bosnia I want to tell you about. And I'd go to Bosnia and say blah, blah, blah for another country. And I felt like a carrier pigeon. I felt, this is really silly. Why am I being the intermediary to tell Sri Lankans and Indians and Palestinians and Rwandans and Kenyans what I'm seeing in other countries? I decided I wanted to form a program to bring them all together. So I invented this program called CONTACT, and it started out with 15 people for a week, and now it's a month-long marathon every year. We bring about 60 people to Brattleboro from generally 25 countries or so each summer. You are welcome to apply if you're interested in taking it yourself. Our students range in age from probably 25 to 75, so no one's out of the picture. And it's a graduate program, so most people have at least a bachelor's degree, but some do not. And we spend a month of study together. When we're done, about a third of the students stay on for a graduate certificate program, which they do online. And they also get a chance to go to a conflict country to study it. And we're going to Rwanda for the past 5 years to study post-conflict in Rwanda since their genocide. And I've done five of these programs in Africa, and now we started them in South Asia. So we started last February in Kathmandu, the capital of Nepal, for South Asians. And the reason I did that is I can't get them into the United States anymore. It's very tough to get into this country. You wouldn't believe how tough it is. And people, last 2 years ago, I selected 10 Pakistanis to attend, hoping I'd get three or four of them, and I got 10 rejections for visas. So I thought, I better move the mountain there. So now we're doing this program also in South Asia, so Pakistanis and Indians and Afghans can be able to be with each other in a peace-building program. And also the U.S. is involved in wars in that part of the world, so it seems important that we're also involved in looking at the roots of peace and teaching there. Okay, so that's the work that I'm doing. And now we're going to talk a little bit about the roots of armed conflict and then get to the roots of peace. Next slide, please. I'm going to be showing you three teaching tools that I use. And I use these teaching tools, they're translated into dozens of different languages, and I use them all over the world. And the first one is an iceberg. And that's a rather formidable photo of an iceberg. And when I ask students if they know what an iceberg is, everybody says yes, because they've all seen the Titanic. The Titanic movie has gone around the world, so everybody understands that the problem with an iceberg is that you can't see most of it. And what you can't see is a danger. So next slide. We have taken the iceberg model and adapted it to look at the causes of conflict. And it's a very nice model because it's very accessible and easy. So what we do is we work with students with a blank iceberg. There's nothing written on it. And people begin to look at the visible and the hidden causes of the conflict they're studying or the conflict they're living through. So if you're looking at a country like Rwanda, which had a genocide in 1994, you can look at the poverty that was visible. You can look at the arms trade, which was visible. But you also have to think about the history of resentment of the divisions between the two major ethnic groups there, of the political manipulation, of the fraudulent elections, of all the things that happened, that would be under the iceberg, things that people don't talk about and don't look at. You have to look at the prejudices that people carry, the stereotypes toward the other side, which again is part of what's under the iceberg. And these things that are invisible, we think are the strongest causes of the conflict. People carry historic wounds over generations. It's very hard to let go when your identity group, your religion, your race, your ethnicity, your language group, whatever it is, has been hurt by another. The stereotypes abound over many generations. And people who have been studying the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, for example, look at the effects of the Holocaust, although it's 60 years ago, at the effects of the Holocaust on the psyches of the people who live in Israel and what that creates, which then creates suffering for the Palestinians, but also internal suffering for those people who are still carrying the legacy. So the wounds and the problems, the assumptions, the hidden needs, the perceptions of people go on for a long time. And when people are done with this iceberg, it'll have 50 things written on it, because we really push. Looking at history, how is history taught? How does that history get transmitted to the next generation? Okay. Here's another very simple and elegant model. It's a tree. Everybody knows what a tree is, and it's very nice. The problem could be racism in America, or homophobia, or America's war in Iraq or Afghanistan, or the problem could be writing a constitution in Nepal, or religious freedom in a certain country. Whatever it is, the students, the groups, identify the problem, and then they look down for the causes, the roots of that problem, and the effects of the problem. All the branches and leaves up there that come up from the roots and through the problem to create the effects. And when we did this in Rwanda a couple of years ago, the people in the group said, and what's interesting about Rwanda, and it's true everywhere, is the leaves fall down and refertilize the roots. And so you have a cycle of leaves and roots, cross-fertilization, creating more and more problems as you go along, which makes it very difficult for the problems to end because you can't move the trees. So again, just showing you how we look at the roots of conflict with models that help people wherever they are in the world in a very accessible way understand what happened. And I want to tell you that people who have been in armed conflict are desperate to find out what happened. How did we do this to each other? How did my nice little boy or girl become a killer? How did we rape our neighbors? How did we kill our husbands and wives? Because in places like Bosnia and Rwanda, people killed their partners. They killed their children. They killed their parents because they were in a frenzy of killing. And they were being fed by the media to kill or be killed. And when it's over and the guns are silenced and people say, we've become monsters. How did this happen? And they're desperate to find out. And my belief is if we don't find out, if we don't help people understand what we've been through, we're going to do it again. And so for me, all this work of teaching peace building and traveling around the world with these little bags of tricks and these workshops to teach people is to help people think of how all this happened in order to make sure it doesn't repeat itself. Because otherwise we're doomed into cycles of violence. And a third model that we use is just to look at what happens to conflict that's not controlled. You want to solve a problem at the lowest possible level from where it happens. This is true if you have a fight with your girlfriend or your boyfriend or your mother. You want to solve it as soon as possible. It's also true with domestic and international conflict, because the longer the conflict goes on, the greater the intensity and the separation between people. So at the bottom here, there's a fairly short distance between the two sides and the problem can be solved. By the time you're up there and the conflict has grown this way, the sides are so far apart that you can't talk to each other anymore. You can't even shout at each other. And what happens is, as you can see, the sides form, the communication stops, the perceptions become distorted, and pretty soon the conflict is out of control. And when the conflict has gotten there, you really can't put the genie back in the box. It's gone. It's out of control. And there's going to be war. There's very little you can do about it by then. So we're always asking people to get into conflict management and problem solving as soon as there is an ethnic dispute, a cross-border dispute, or whatever it is, to make sure it doesn't keep happening. Okay, let's move on, please. So this is a picture that I took in Bosnia just after the war. Bosnia had a mass violence in 1992 to 1995 that hasn't yet been healed. They're still working on it. And we can go to the next slide. And this is, these are the kind of images that we're pretty desensitized to because of TV and computers and video games and movies. We see so much violence that we hardly see it. And we hardly can imagine what it's like to live through it. And sometimes I can't even imagine that Americans could live through the kind of suffering that people around the world are living through. That we're so comfortable, we're so sure of ourselves, that we would have a very hard time living through this. When I went to Bosnia just after the genocide there, I was going 3 or 4 times a year and staying for a few weeks, and everything around me was destroyed. There wasn't a building standing, there wasn't a flower, there wasn't any green grass, there wasn't a school, there wasn't anything. And I saw it's very harsh to live with such ugliness. It must be very hard to recover when everything around you has been utterly destroyed. And every place you look outside the window, you see destruction. I was teaching in a half-bombed out school in the gym that still had blood on the floor. And you imagine what it's like for the Bosnians to walk into that school and know what happened to the children for that blood. So we're talking about very serious situations with that require an enormous capacity to reconcile and forgive for people to live together. In Rwanda, they killed 1 million people in 100 days. Do the math. That's a lot of death every day. 1 million people in 100 days. And there's no place, this was between the Hutus and the Tutsis, there's no place to move when the violence is done. Your neighbor is still your neighbor. The kids in the class are still the kids in the class from both ethnic groups. You can't pick people up and move them to a new country. There are no new countries. After World War II, that happened with the Israelis when so many went to what was then Palestine and formed a new country. And look at the trouble we've had for 60 years since then. So that's not a solution either. So there's no place for people to go who have killed each other. They have to face each other. And imagine having to do that for the rest of your life. And I see incredible power of forgiveness. Some of the stuff I can barely believe that I see. I see Rwandans who come out of prison, where they've been for many years, to have a homegrown trial called gachacha, which means justice on the grass, sitting on the grass in their community with judges from their community and telling all the people who are listening to them, many more people than this, what crimes they committed. If they tell the truth, and if the Rwandans in the community feel that they're telling the truth with remorse, with compassion, with the right amount of guilt and responsibility for what they've done, they're brought back into the community. And there's been no revenge killing. It's amazing. No revenge killing. If they don't tell the truth, or if they tell the truth from a kind of a hard-boiled place, they're sent back to prison. To think about it again. It's an interesting word. The original word for prison was penitentiary. Comes from the word penitent, which means to be reflective. So once upon a time, a prison was a place to go and be reflective, not a place to go for brutal punishment. And so these Rwandans go back into prison for penitent time, reflective time, and then they can come out again, go back into their community, ask for forgiveness, and be allowed back home. So there's a lot of very tender experiences that people are going through of forgiving each other. In Nepal, where I'm working now, they had, not genocide, but they had a Maoist revolution, a 10-year war, and a lot of violence. And some of the Maoists who committed violence now want to go back home. So I was working with some community people, and I said, have you had any Maoists return to your village? And they said, yes. 10 people tried to come back to our village. And I said, what did you do? And they said, we tied them up. Oh, you tied them up. Why did you tie them up? We wanted an apology. They didn't want money. They didn't want to kill them. They didn't want them to give back land or animals or anything else. They wanted an apology. So interesting. That's what the human heart needs after violence, an apology. So I said, what happened? They said, well, we kept them tied up for 2 days, and then they apologized. I don't know if you would trust that kind of apology, because they must have been a little agitated after 2 days, but it's such a good teaching story about what the human heart needs and how far people want to go to reconcile with others. And then in that case, those 10 Maoists move back in, and again, there's been no revenge killing. So those are the kind of experiences that I see around the world that give me heart. Okay, let's move on, please. Walls. Walls are a problem. Where are those walls? Any guesses? What?
Palestine.
Okay, the one on the right is in separating Israel and Palestine. On the Palestinian side, I've been there a lot. On the Palestinian side, the Palestinians paint on the walls. The walls are ugly. They're enormously high and they're incredibly ugly. And there's a dream of a child holding onto balloons and being able to fly over the wall. It's a very touching dream. It's very hard to live with walls. Very hard on the people who have to live behind the walls. And walls are a way of walling the other off, saying, you don't exist, I can't see you anymore, I can push you out of my mind because you've ceased to exist for me. Where's the other wall? US-Mexico, Abby gets the prize. That's our wall. That's our wall. A colleague of mine took that photo. She's working in peace building strictly on that issue. And again, on the other side of the wall is unbelievable suffering. Don't want to see it. Push it out of our lives. Make it into a wall.
Where's that wall again?
Arizona. Oh, and this woman's a Californian, and she told me that the wall starts in the Pacific Ocean between San Diego and Tijuana, not just on the land, in the ocean, to make sure nobody can swim around it, and goes from Tijuana all the way across to Texas. So this is our way of saying there are people we don't want to see. There are problems that are related to our own country that we don't want to talk about. So we also wall people off. Next slide. What?
Our tax dollars
at work, unfortunately. Yeah, our tax dollars at work. So let's go to the next slide, please. And this is another phenomenon I want to talk about. It's called enemy images. It's a very important piece of my own thinking about the roots of violence and the roots of peace. One is communism, one is, I don't even know what that other one is supposed to represent. It's Japan, yes, Japan, with the rising sun hat. So these are old images, but they're images every day. Enemy images are making a exaggerated cartoon-like figure of the other. What's the purpose of it? What does it do?
Fear.
It dehumanizes. That's exactly the right word. It dehumanizes the other. It says, I can kill, because that's not a human being. when the U.S. servicemen were training to kill in Vietnam, they were told that these were not humans, these were gooks or geeks or...
Gooks.
It's not a human word. In Rwanda, when they were setting up the genocide, they called the Tutsis who they were killing cockroaches. You can step out a cockroach, it's not a human being. So geeks and gooks and commies and ragheads is a nasty word for people from Muslim descent or Arab descent. These are words that dehumanize, all the words that African Americans have been called in this country for centuries. It takes it away from the humanness. It's really hard to kill. The army has learned how to teach people how to kill. Because killing violates everything you've learned since you started kindergarten. Everything about nice and sharing your toys and playing with others and don't hit Johnny on the head with your shovel, all of that that we learn as little children has to be unlearned and relearned in order to kill. And so there are psychological ways that people were taught to kill, and one of them is this massive dehumanization. I have a colleague who returned from Pakistan yesterday. He's got as much jet lag as I do. We were both on the email at 4 o'clock this morning because I'm just back from Nepal and he's just back from Pakistan. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, I read his email talking about visiting the flood-prone areas of Pakistan and how grown men were crying in front of him because of the loss of dignity, because they've lost their land, they've lost their honor, they've lost their way that they're going to take care of their families. And they are so angry with the Americans for the enemy images. These are people who are so fragile and vulnerable now, and yet what they know about how we teach and how we see people from that part of the world is in these enemy images, and they're really painful. So trying to work with this and make sure that we're not doing this with the Mexicans on the other side of the border or the Pakistanis on the other side of the world or anybody else in our own community is really important because they're very damaging. Let's move on. Okay, next slide. That's Bosnia. It's working in Bosnia. This is the last teaching tool I want to show you. There's a peace sign in the middle, and it looks at human needs and human rights, and it talks about them in three dimensions, social, cultural, and material. And what this diagram says is if you meet people's basic human needs, if you promote them, you have cycles of peace and justice. If you deny people's human needs, you have cycles of violence. People will kill if their community is starving. If you say, all the people on this side of the room can't have any water anymore, and you're going to keep all the water over there, they're going to kill you because it's such a basic need they can't survive. But if you take away their identity, they may kill you also. So it isn't just the material needs. It's not just the food, the water, the land. It's also the dignity, the right to work, the right to have one's identity, one's religion, one's culture, one's language, etc., that cause a great deal of murder. So if you deny any combination of these things, you are absolutely guaranteed to have cycles of violence. It's not rocket science, this business of building peace. It's really not. It's pretty obvious. And if you promote good governance and shared opportunity for people and restorative justice measures and reconciliation and mediation and respect for law and human rights and all of that, you get this culture of peace that I talked about earlier. You build a culture of peace. Okay, let's move on. These are some photos that are taken in four different parts of the world. This is my work in promoting cultures of peace. This is Palestine, Senegal, Pakistan, and Nepal. And these are people in the workshops that we do. They're just ordinary people, just like ourselves, who are attempting to build cultures of peace after a great deal of mass violence. And I want to end with some comments by our Nobel laureates. I had the privilege of meeting Tutu last year at a conference in Cape Town, and he's a rather beaming, incredible individual. South Africa is looking at 10 to 15 years now after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and wondering what to do. They've had the most important post-war commission to look at issues of peace and justice the planet's ever had, and there's still mass violence and incredible amounts of economic injustice, which is making it a very dangerous place because there's just no opportunity for people. And so there was a conference, and he was the keynote speaker, and I was also speaking, so I had a chance to meet him. And I love that quote, without forgiveness, there's no future. We will continue, unless we forgive each other, to punish each other for former violences and continue to have more violence. And yet, when you think about how hard it is to forgive someone who slighted you or broke up with you or hurt you in some way on a personal level, imagine how hard it is to forgive a government that oppressed your people the way the South African apartheid government did for a century. Now, how do you do that? And what happens if you don't? I have a wonderful colleague who's a Rwandan living in this country now, and he lost his parents in the genocide, and 7 out of his 10 siblings, and all his siblings' husbands and wives and children. So he lost 50, 60, 80 family members. And he said for years he walked around like this because he was so angry. And when you're angry, your fist is closed, your heart is closed, your mind is closed. And he finally saw, what am I doing to myself? Who's being punished? He saw that he was hurting himself. And it wasn't until he could open his fists psychologically and let go of the revenge feelings he felt that he could live a life. And he has 5 kids, and he said, if I spend my life like this, what's the message to my kids? They're gonna wind up killing the other side. They're gonna go back and kill Hutus because their family were killed as Tutsis. So he learned that he had to, for his mental health, his spiritual health, and the health of the next generation, he had to forgive, which is exactly what the Archbishop is teaching us, that no matter how hard it is, we have to do it. I met a young man when I was in Rwanda who was in his 20s, and he said to me, his name was Eddie, he said, 23 people of my family were killed, and I promised myself I would commit 23 murders. By the time I met him, he was in one of my peace workshops, and I said, Eddie, what happened? He said, I got involved in studying peace. And I got involved in going to a charismatic church. And I began to hear a whole different message. And now I'm working for peace to save lives instead of killing lives. So people make these enormous transformations that we're all capable of. And our next slide is another. These are now all Nobel laureates. I'm just going to end with about 4 of these quotes just to remind us of what's possible. This was taken when Mandela was still in prison, obviously. If you want to make peace with your enemy, you have to work with your enemy, and then your enemy becomes your friend. So how do you convert from enemyism to friendship? And the next one is, I love this, Mother Teresa. The problem with the world is we draw our family circles too small. So ask yourself, who's in your circle? Who do you leave out of your circle? Is this your circle? Is this your circle? Is this your circle? Is this your circle? Who's out of it? Who do you kick out of your circle? And what's the result? If you kick people out because of a certain religion or race or sexual preference or identity or dislike, what's the result of that? What happens to all that suffering? It doesn't go nowhere. It's in the universe. It's going to come back in one way or another. So think about your circle and think about what you can do as an individual to take your own circle, open it up a little bit. Okay? And the last slide, of course, is one of our own wisdom figures reminding us that this is the work we have to do in order for us to live together. Okay, let's just go right through these, please. These are some pictures of the Contact Program in Vermont. I just wanted to show you a sense of what we do there. And this is also in the Contact Program. And the quote is from a Pakistani who came to our program in South Asia last year. And people in this group are from Nepal, Rwanda, Liberia, America, Cambodia, and Somalia. So again, it's a very international mix of people all learning together. Okay, and this is Joseph Severenzi. This is the Rwandan I told you about, the tall guy in the front with the suit. And this is a quote from him, because he's teaching with me now. So he went from being a victim of genocide to now a professor in peace and conflict studies. And let's finish up. And this is a picture with Bosnian women, Bosnian Muslims and Bosnian Serbs after the genocide there, who couldn't imagine they could talk to each other and then get to a place where there's a great deal of intimacy and a great deal of trust, because they've been exploring together over the years. And this is a photo of hands that we use in the contact program as a way to remind us of the work that we have to do together. So that's the end of my slideshow. I wanted to get done before 1 o'clock, because some of you have a class, and I wanted to have time for some questions. So let's open it up for questions and comments. Yes, please.
So I want you to speak to, you know, people holding on to idealism in the face of closed hands, mm-hmm. and then, quote unquote, lose as a result, and lose in a very significant way.
Yeah, it's a million-dollar question. You know, clearly, in my talking about this man who had to forgive, he's not a political leader, and the situation with Obama, I think the situation with Obama is very different as a political leader than it was for this colleague that I spoke about, who was a private citizen. And I don't have any idea where the wisdom is in terms of what Obama should be doing. I don't think Obama knows. I don't think the best minds in Washington know quite how to reverse the pattern that has been established right now with people who are pretty non-cooperative with trying to do anything in Washington. And I can only hope that this movement will rise and pass away quickly. I heard something on the radio just driving up here just now on NPR. Bill Clinton was saying that he lost in 1994 when Newt Gingrich came in, and there was another one of these contracts with America. Now they have the agenda for America. And Bill Clinton said he lost that election, but he didn't lose the presidency in 1996. He won again because it was proven to people that it was shallow. When they had to try to govern, when they could no longer be the outside party, but they were then one of the inside parties who had to govern because they won the House, it then proved to the country that they couldn't. They were not willing to govern because they were the party of no at that time. So whether or not that'll happen again, I don't know. But I don't have the wisdom, I don't think anybody has the wisdom to know how this is gonna turn itself around. It's very frightening, to be sure.
Remember you saying that your program tries to stay out of countries where you're not wanted or needed.
Yeah.
Are there any current countries right now where you wish they would invite you?
Well, I'm not invited by the government. I'm invited by people in civil society generally. And so even if there's a conflict with their government and our government, like Pakistan or Afghanistan, there are people who want us there, and I'm really happy to go. And I guess the places that I want to go the most are the ones where there's the most conflict, especially with America involved in it. And it's really important for people around the world who have strong anti-American feelings when Americans show up who are doing something good for the country. And my presence matters. I get 50% of my points just for showing up, whether I do anything or don't do anything. The fact that I've risked my life, you know, put myself out there, gone to these countries, and I'm saying I'm here and I'm here to help you and I'm here to work as partners with you in trying to build peace and justice matters tremendously. So I'm interested in going to the places where the conflict is. And so working in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Israel, Palestine, where I'll be next month, Rwanda, other parts of the world where there's conflict, seems really important to me. It's where the work is.
What are your thoughts about what's happening in Mexico now?
I don't work in Mexico, so I can't speak any more than you can speak as a private citizen. But I feel that there's a spiritual teacher named Thich Nhat Hanh, a Buddhist meditation teacher, who says, this is like this because that is like that. which is a wonderful comment on interconnection. And what's going on the other side of the border is related to what's going on this side of the border. And I think because we're neighbors, the U.S. has a special obligation to be helping the Mexicans. And what we're doing instead is pouring in guns and buying drugs, and it's not working well. So again, I'm a private citizen around Mexico. It's not a place where I've ever had done any peace building, but I think that the approach is not working. Obviously, there's tremendous suffering, and a lot of that suffering is right at the other side of the wall.
I just wondered if in the last presidential election, some may recall, Dennis Kucinich proposed the Department of Peace.
Speak up.
He's asking about the Department of Peace.
Yeah, and he continues. I mean, he hasn't been speaking about it recently. But the idea of a Department of Peace, which would be a cabinet-level post, it would be a Secretary of Peace.
Yes.
And it seemed the mission was to very much approach the problems the way you've described, which is to look at the roots, look for the roots, look at the conditions that would lead to war and to preempt those this time, peace preemption instead of war preemption.
Well, it's a great idea. I mean, there's a lot of great ideas that have never been tried. There's a U.S. Institute of Peace in Washington that does very good work, and they actually, they give grants. We've gotten grants from them to do our work overseas, but there's no cabinet-level Ministry of Peace, and there should be. The Defense Ministry used to be the Ministry of War. Then we cleaned it up and called it Defense Ministry, but it's still the Ministry of War. And there needs to be a counterbalance with the Ministry of Peace. And whether that'll ever happen in our lifetimes is completely unknown. Yes? You're next.
I'm very concerned about what I've seen personally around people who are suffering with hate in this country.
Yeah.
And young people, teenagers, who say hateful things, who think that that's the way to be paid in this society, who obviously are saying hateful things because they're angry. And I think that's, I can relate to the iceberg image, because it's what they hear at home. Probably their families are angry. Angry, and this is before the depression, but the recession. This is before I even just 10 years ago. And I was on one of the walks that the Buddhists was doing through Franklin County. The anger and the hate for the young people was right there. And I was thinking, then, there's got to be some way to repair. But how? How to repair those broken?
Well, I think it's a very important point, and I think this is kind of a multi-level answer. One is economic justice, because a lot of people who are angry are suffering, and under the anger is pain, and it gets expressed as anger, but it's pain. And it gets contorted into hate, and I think economic justice, living in a country that is more just, and where the gap between the rich and the poor is not so wide, and there's real opportunity for people, creates a society of less hatred. And I saw that in Norway last summer, and I've seen it in the Netherlands, and I've seen it in so many other European countries, Canadian provinces, et cetera, where you don't get this level of animosity because you don't have this kind of particular suffering. And I also think we have a media that's out of control, and media could be a force for enormous social change and social good, enormous. And it's not. It's a force that replicates and recreates over and over again the negative images and the stereotypes. And our educational system is failing us. We're not teaching our kids conflict resolution. We're not teaching them compassion. We're not teaching them social justice. You know, none of these things exist in elementary school. And so we're not, from the ground up, we're not teaching people about respect for others and about the damage of prejudice. And the cycle of socialization that creates prejudice begins in the home and continues in the school and the media and the religious institutions and the government and goes on and spreads to the next generation. There's a camp called Seeds of Peace in Maine. It's a wonderful international camp. It was founded originally for Israeli and Palestinian high school kids. And now they take Indians and Pakistanis and Rwandans, and they have kids from the UK and Ireland and all different parts of the world. And what they saw is that the Israeli and Palestinian kids spent a summer and they worked really hard on their prejudices and their dehumanization. They went home feeling fabulous about the other, but they went back to a toxic environment, and they couldn't hold it because they were 16. They were in their families, embedded in their families, who had all the prejudices and the community, and it was so hard to hold on to your ideals. So it has to happen at the family level, but also has to happen on the school community media level, so that as people are exposed and change, there is a container that can hold those changes. Otherwise, they disappear. You had a hand up someplace here. Was it you? Back there, yes, please. That's a very interesting question. In South Africa, people would say, I'm ready to forgive, but I need to know who to forgive. And in some cases, you don't know who to forgive. And in some cases, the killers have not asked for forgiveness. But forgiveness is for your own sake. Forgiveness is not for anybody else. If I have to forgive someone, it's because it's going to help me. And in a case like my colleague Joseph, he's forgiven, but people that killed his family don't know that. So forgiveness is a personal act and doesn't require another. And you do it because you have to for your own sanity and your own well-being, not because it benefits or doesn't benefit anybody else, because nobody else knows about it. There's an interesting story out of South Africa. Maybe I'll end with that if people have to go. When I was there for this conference, a South African videographer showed a film he had made, and it was a story of a white apartheid policeman who had been guilty of a lot of atrocities during the apartheid era, and he had a cancer diagnosis and he was dying. And because of his religious beliefs, he felt that he needed to confess his crimes before he died. And so he goes to the home of a black family. This takes place in South Africa, and it's captured on video. And he goes to the home of a couple who were probably in their 60s. They're sitting in their living room in their little township. He goes to apologize to them for having killed their son. And it's fascinating because this guy goes in, he makes his apology, and the parents don't forgive him, but they don't throw him out either. They hear him out and they listen to him. And he's turning to leave, and from the bedroom comes a 15-year-old who was a baby when his father was killed. So his father's killer has come into the house. And this 15-year-old is holding a piece of crockery, like a pitcher, and he throws it at the policeman's head and cracks open his head. This is all on film. And it was such an important teaching about this white guy has come into this family's home for himself, for his own sake. Did he ever bother to say, I'm going to educate this kid? I'm going to help this family? I'm going to help them get jobs. I'm going to try to lift them out of poverty. I'm going to do something because I made this family have no son and no father. It was totally for him. And the kid was so angry that his father's killer dared to walk into his house. And he couldn't kill him. He just threw a pitcher at him and hurt him. But it's such a lesson in how deep this is and how long it goes on. And it's like this kid had his moment of revenge, and there was nothing else he could do except to try to hurt back this man who had hurt his family so much, because in his eyes it was total selfishness. It was not about the black family. It was about his needing to get this off his chest so he could go to heaven. It's pretty interesting. So this may be a good place to stop. It's after one. I'm happy to hang out with people who want to hang out, but thank you for being here and thank you for listening.